to the Final Four, and we're heading for home in Lexington, Kentucky, Rupp Arena. This is third round action from the East Region. The number six seed, the Butler Bulldogs, matched up with the Marquette Golden Eagles. The winner here will advance to Washington, D.C., and face the winner of the Miami-Illinois game, which is coming up tomorrow night on TNT. Welcome courtside, everybody. Ian Eagle along with Jim Spinarkle. Allie LaForce will join us as well. These two teams were tested in the second round here at the NCAA tournament. Let's start with Marquette. It took everything they had to get past Davidson. It was a remarkable rally, and they're not in this third round without the play of Vander Blue.
Exactly. It was a possession game, and every possession really meant a lot in this game. Vander Blue did not have a terrific shooting game, 5-15, but throughout the season, he's the guy that they have gone to, and down the stretch when they needed a bucket, here's his game-winning drive to seal the victory.
As for Butler, a 22-5 run to defeat Bucknell at the end of the game. Bucknell had actually taken the lead. Brad Stevens took a timeout. Butler was able to regroup.
Right.
Rodney Clark struggled to start the game. First half, just couldn't make shots. Second half, he got it going.
Well, like Vander Blue, he's the same type of guy. He looks to get his shot off a little bit more than Blue does. Always looking to take shots and really stroke from the outside. But here is the big one. Coming off a high screen away from the basket, he was 5-14. But they got him the ball when it mattered.
And a rivalry developing. Marquette and Butler will both be in the new look Big East next season. They go head-to-head in the NCAA tournament. March Madness next on CBS. Back here in Lexington, Brad Stevens, head coach at Butler. His team has now won its first game in six of the last seven NCAA tournaments that they've played in. Let's take a look at the starting five. Alex Barlow gets the start once again. He was terrific in the victory over Bucknell. Rodney Clark, Roosevelt Jones, Kyle Marshall, and Andrew Smith round out the starting five for the Bulldogs. Marquette, Junior Cadugan, Vander Blue, Trent Lockett, Juan Anderson, and Chris Otule. For fifth-year head coach, 41-year-old Buzz Williams, that 59-58 come-from-behind victory over Davidson in the second round. They shot just 34%. In fact, they started 1 of 12 from three-point territory against Davidson, but boy, did they ever hit some big ones down the stretch of that game.
Yeah, when we look at this pace compared to the game we just viewed with Louisville, the way they were up and down and really forcing the tempo, neither one of these two teams try to play that way, so this will be a more of a possession-type game.
Michael Stewart officiating in his 14th NCAA tournament, along with Lamont Simpson and Jeffrey Anderson. That's our officiating crew with Smith and Otule there to jump it up. Winner goes to Washington, D.C. The three seed in the East, Marquette, against the six seed, Butler. It's a rematch, first meeting November the 19th in Maui. Butler, a 72-71 win. Rodney Clark with a three-pointer at the buzzer. Marquette controls the tip. Outside, Anderson spread the floor with Blue. Junior Cadugan, the senior from Toronto. Blue gives it up for Lockett. Lockett the drive, the curl to the rim. Bank shot, no. And it's rebounded by Smith down low. He had 16 boards in a win over Bucknell.
Had 14 points to go with that. So that's one of the matchups to look for to keep him busy from a Marquette perspective. And obviously they're going to try to just stay on top of Clark the entire time. Blue has him now.
Smith gets a touch on the inside. Double team comes. And a foul called. Coming over, Juan Anderson as the help defender. Marquette 20-6 with this starting lineup. Shared the regular season Big East title with Louisville and Georgetown, and Buzz Williams will make a change 42 seconds in.
Yeah, what's up with Cadugan? Anything or?
Well, right now he's sitting.
Yeah, I know.
Derek Wilson is in for him. Jump shot doesn't go for Clark. Struggles from three-point territory. Nice. 2 of 8 from beyond the arc the other night. Jamil Wilson is in for Marquette, and he really stood out down the stretch. Made some big plays for Marquette in the victory against Davidson. Back in, Wilson on a fadeaway. Book it.
may very well be the most talented player on this team. You would think that after those shots that he hit, they're going to try to ride him a little bit, but this is going to be a key matchup out front. Blue on Clark. Will Clark drive him crazy going off screens looking for his shots?
Clark trying to feed the post. Roosevelt Jones inside, and it rims out. Jones able to come up with the offensive board. Wheels on the interior for two.
Well, that's Jones's game there. Good first, second-round game. There's a little push. That could be interesting, too, the way he keeps them busy at the offensive end of the floor. Now, here's the post-up area, and that's a nice fall-away jump shot by Wilson. Hard to defend that with his length at 6'7".
Foul called against Barlow. Cadogan getting ready to check back in. And Vander Blue at the free-throw line, where he shoots it at 73%. He had 16 points. And to come from behind victory in the second round. Marquette has won 7 of its last 9 games, 8 straight trips to the NCAA tournament. Blue had 21 points against Butler in the first meeting in Maui. And here comes Cadogan, so he'll replace Wilson.
Butler had 4 double-figure scorers in that game also, and the one you just referenced in Maui. So, but you know what, though? In college basketball, that was a lifetime ago, wasn't it? These teams have changed. They've made adjustments, so they remember it. But I'm not so sure they're scouting off that game. They're scouting more off what this team's been doing in the last 2 weeks.
Very early in the season, right, in November, and Butler didn't even have its rotation set at that point. The drive, Jones on a kick out, jump shot, it's Barlow, a 3. He continues to produce for the Bulldogs, the former walk-on.
Don't look for Barlow to score much, but you're right about the other night. He played very well.
Catch and shoot, Wilson drains the triple.
They're spreading the floor. Marquette, not a team that really goes outside real well at all, 30% as a team. And he has the ability to knock it back at around 36%. So, but I like the confidence level he's showing right now to take advantage of it.
Here's Clark, confident shooter. Rodney Clark knocks it down for 3. There's Lockett, one-on-one with Jones. 8-7, Butler in front. Spread the floor with Cadogan. The spin. Side of the backboard. Good defense there by Barlow. And last touch by Marquette.
Well, you're going to see the spacing of the floor. Watch over here on the right-hand side. Find the spot. Draw defenders so they slide on you. They don't have any opportunity to get out there. And as I mentioned, with his length at 6'7", he's going to shoot over most guys. And in particular, just then, it was Marshall a little late to the party.
Devontae Gardner and Derek Wilson are in for Marquette. So Cadogan will sit once again. And now Otule gets an early rest. Just about 3 minutes gone by in this first half. Butler up by 1. Here's some pressure from the Golden Eagles. Jones one-on-one with Wilson on the outside. Clark, tight defense there from Derek Wilson. Smith gives it up. Extra feed for Jones.
He's not going to shoot that from there, Jones. You got to back off him.
Jones, the drive, rejected by Lockett. Knocked to the outside. Jones, the 3 ball doesn't go. Wilson couldn't grab it. Quick pass, Barlow to Smith. In and out, but he's going to the free throw line. That's a heads-up play by Alex Barlow to get rid of it as quickly as he did. Oh, Butler, that dramatic early season moment. Rodney Clark, the 3-pointer at the buzzer. Take a look at that. Just as Brad Stevens drew it up.
Yeah, the easiest shot you'll ever take.
72-71 win in Maui. Gardner called on the foul for Marquette. Andrew Smith, 72% shooter, a part of the 2 Butler teams that went to back-to-back national championship games, really setting the tone for Butler, no longer considered a Cinderella. In fact, going to the Big East next year, so they can't even be called a mid-major anymore. They're going to be in a quote-unquote power conference.
Those days are over, my friend. Not that they were in a simple league this year, hey, in the A-10, right?
No. Cameron Woods is in for Butler. Wilson taking the baseline. To the corner, Lockett. Count it, a 3.
Well, I think Marquette comes out shooting the basketball well from the outside. Not a forte of this team. They were only 4 of 15 from the stripe against Davidson.
Lockett, the transfer from Arizona State. Buzz Williams said he's the most diligent worker I've ever been around. Rodney Clark, who continues to work on that jump shot. Takes as many practice jumpers as anybody in the nation.
I was just going to say, Ian, when you start talking about guys who work hard with their game, you got to put Clark in there.
Wilson on a dump down. Good position. Gardner is fouled. Woods climbed over his back. So Gardner will shoot free throws when we come back in our first stoppage here in the first half.
Ian and Jim.
All right, Greg, Pac-12 advances with Arizona over Harvard. And there's that Iowa State-Ohio State matchup in Dayton on CBS tomorrow afternoon. Butler up by two. Devontae Gardner at the free throw line, 84% on the season. Junior from Suffolk, Virginia, cuts the Butler lead to one.
Good pace early in, early on in this game, Ian, with the team shooting the ball pretty well. 4 of 8 for Butler, 3 of 5 for Marquette, but the turnover 0-0. So far, a little offensive passing. These two teams will run the sets pretty nicely.
Two teams that really struggled from three-point territory in the last round. Butler is 3 of 4 so far tonight. Marquette is 2 out of 2. Butler up by one as Gardner misses on the second attempt. Wow. At a 10-second call, Clark just took his time. Wilson actually backed off. And Brad Stevens telling Clark, hey, get it across, be aware. That's the first turnover of the game.
A little bit of Wilson and Wilson just then. One on him, one pulls back. And you're right, Clark just really didn't hurry to get that across half court.
Chris O'Toole is back in for Marquette. Here's Blue on the stop and go. Swatted out of there by Smith.
That was kind of like a game winner the other night, wasn't it? But Smith had to redirect that a bit.
Blue got around Jake Cohen for the game winner. Smith was waiting for Blue in the post. Smith feeds it. Clark catching fire. Short. Smith keeps it alive. Knocked to the outside. Great save. Cameron Woods hitting the table on the side, but he does maintain possession for Butler.
That was a flat-out terrific effort by Woods. He took a shot to the gut with the table also. Looks okay, though.
Freshman Kellen Dunham is in for Butler. Dunham gets a touch on the perimeter. Now it's Smith. Double team, a hard double. They back off.
There you go. Somebody's open.
It's Woods. Rebounded by Cadogan. Marquette on the push. Blue probing. Lockett using the O'Toole screen. Cadogan drops it inside. The seal by O'Toole, and he puts it in. The senior from Richmond, Texas. He's dealt with so many injuries throughout his career. 2 broken feet. 1 his freshman year. 1 his sophomore year. A torn ACL his left knee last year. And Buzz Williams has just been so happy that O'Toole has remained healthy and has been such a big part of this run for Marquette.
And when he's on the floor, they have to get him his touches offensively. There's no question about that, to keep Smith active at the defensive end in the post.
13-12, Marquette leading Butler. 3-6 matchup here in the East Regional. Tip ball on the inside as Smith couldn't get a clean look. 13:35 remaining in the first half. Ian Eagle, Jim Spinarco, Ali LaForce, and the rest of our CBS crew. Final game here in Lexington. Here's Wilson, hard drive. O'Toole fumbles initially, left hand, no. A battle for it inside, knocked out of bounds, and it was touched last by Woods.
These are the types of plays that this tournament is all about. Rejection by Smith right there, well timed, and here's one. Save the basketball, watch the gut. Yep, he gets the monitor of one of the computers over there. The stat monitor is right in the stomach.
And apparently the stat monitor is okay. I know you were concerned.
I'm going to go down there and check it out.
Taylor trying to get it to Cadogan, and Barlow did touch it, so Cadogan able to go back and get it cleanly.
And that didn't touch Cadogan then, so it was okay.
Lock it inside. Taps it over to Gardner, bumping bodies. And he's going to the free throw line. Eric Fromm will get called for the foul for Butler. The winner here goes to Washington, D.C. in the Sweet 16 to take on the winner of the Illinois-Miami game coming up in Austin tomorrow night on TNT. Officials heading over to the monitor right now. Foul was called on the junior Eric Fromm of the Bulldogs. Marquette up by one. Just about 7 minutes gone by in this first half. Buzz Williams told us this is a really fun group to coach. Great chemistry, togetherness, accountability. Feels like the team morphed and evolved as the season has gone on.
Take a look here, see what's going on. Is there anything... Yeah, it's relatively clean. I'm thinking that maybe in the traffic somebody did something. There's a bump.
That was a foul on Fromm against Devontae Gardner.
I thought it was pretty straightforward in terms of who the shooter is. That's one of the things that they can look at.
And the other, I don't see anything that would be in the flagrant one or two, right? Oh, there you go, out front. Okay, so it's a swing of that elbow. Here it comes with the left. Watch, it's going to come back right here. Ready? Bang.
And so Farlow took the shot to the chin. And still feeling it on the side of his jaw.
It's going to be real interesting to me how they rule this one. I know, you know, some people say, and we've had a lot of discussions on this here, people believe that the offensive player should have some space, and that by rule is not the case. So you can come up and do exactly what the defender Barlow did right there. But, you know, it's...
Flagrant one, excessive contact, non-excessive elbow contact above the shoulders or pushing or holding a player from behind to prevent the score. By the letter of the law, that's going to be a flagrant one.
Well, it's the non-excessive, right? The elbow above the head or above the shoulders, right? So, but to me, I see what's going on here. I mean, this is the play, but I'm thinking that college basketball has to make a change on that, because if you come up and ride that guy chest to chest, and I understand what he's doing from a defensive standpoint, a lot of people say, well, you need some space. If you're not going to give me the space, then I have to have the ability to make a basketball move if you're closing in. And if that's going to be what I consider an inadvertent elbow, I don't think there was anything intentional right there in terms of hitting you with the elbow. I'm just not sure I... Now, by rule, I'm saying they're going to get this right.
They are.
And they're probably going to call it a flagrant one, I would guess. But I don't like that rule right there.
There is nothing in the rule that we just showed you that mentions the word intentional.
Correct.
And that's where you have to separate what you have seen through the years as a basketball player, as an analyst, you've been doing this a long time, and as an official.
Yeah, and not to go way back in time, but in the old days, and I'll just put old days around it, when you look at, you used to take those shots all time, and you'd play through them.
100% correct.
Yeah. Because you knew, now obviously I don't want to get hit in the mouth with an elbow, right? It's going to stop you. You're going to look at the guy's number and hopefully even it out somewhere without hurting somebody. But the way it is right now.
Jimmy, you got it. We've got a flagrant one.
So it is a flagrant one called on Trent Lockett.
We're going to shoot the two shots here first.
Gardner's going to get his free throws because the foul was called on Fromm underneath. Buzz Williams is looking for an extended explanation from Eric Curry, the standby official at the table.
So, shots here. He'll take his shots.
I'm in agreement with you, by the way, just to go on record.
Thank you. Not that I, you know.
It used to be the case that as a defensive player, you'd get the message that maybe you need to step back a bit if you took a shot to the chin with no call on it. But by the letter of the law, what these officials have been told, whether it was the intent, not the intent, it's the result. And if you take an elbow above the shoulder, you're going to get called on it.
Right. And I don't, the, by rule, they're getting this correct. It's just me throwing a couple of my opinions out there. And I just put this under the term of accidental. Because you know what? If he wanted to hit him harder than that, he would not be standing right now to defend it. So now he's going to take his two shots here.
And Barlow comes up short, 75% shooter.
And then by rule, once again, Butler will get the ball going back down the other end of the floor, approximately where that foul occurred.
Your basketball instinct would tell you, hey, play on.
Yeah.
But the rule that we showed indicates that that's going to get called every time.
Yeah, and I also, not to belabor the point, but I think there are situations where you really have to call that in a hurry. You know, rebound, guy gets the rebound, swings the arms quickly, and hits you. It's a little different in terms of the intensity. Out on the court right there, in front of this whole crowd, the whole crowd could see me hit that guy, you know?
You thought that was within the flow of the game.
I did, but by rule, they got it correct.
Marquette up by two. Butler with the basketball. And a travel called on Barlow. So Butler turns it over. They had just five turnovers in the win over Bucknell on Thursday. But they shot just 36%, including 3 of 17 from three-point range. Butler has won 11 of its last 13 NCAA tournament games. Wilson looking down low. Gardner couldn't break free. Here's Cadogan now trying to create the curl. Dunham with the block. And that time, some contact underneath the other way.
Cadogan, I think, after the shot gets blocked, clean block by Dunham. You have that one right. Now watch. He gets popped right in the face.
Roosevelt Jones going down. And it will be Cadogan picking up his first.
See, here's just the other part of that point, right, when you look at it. The elbow is a dangerous part of the body, right, when you're swinging it around. But there's a shot where a guy smacks him in the face, and it's just a common foul.
Mm-hmm.
So you got to start with that particular play. It's got to be tweaked a little bit. And I know that, once again, it could be done. You could do a whole lot more damage with the elbow than a smack.
From buries the three. Eric Fromm stepping back, a 30% shooter from long range. And he's given Butler a one-point lead.
He actually takes more threes than twos.
They bring two defenders to Gardner. Cross court, good find. Wilson,
good no call there, too.
Bullet feed down low. Lockett looking to create space. Gets rid of it.
I'll tell you, Butler locks it up with the front line.
Wilson drops it in for Gardner. And a foul called. It's Wilson on the offensive foul.
Yes, so here's your elbow. All right, there's the flagrant one. And then there's the slap to the face. Physical play, both ends.
See real stories of human achievement featured on the Buick Human Highlight Reel at NCAA.com/Buick. First Marquette turnover of the half. They trail Butler 16-15. 11:50 to play in this first half. Butler shooting at 5 of 12. Marquette is 4 out of 10. Barlow remains on the floor with Fromm, Clark, Woods, and Dunham.
They are just rotating defenders on Clark to make sure he doesn't get off.
Lob up top, Woods, a major leaper, and he has it slapped away by Lockett from behind.
It's a pretty odd alley-oop play, wasn't it? Tossing that ball from about 35, 40 feet away just to stay in the air long enough for Woods to do anything with it.
Otule and Blue are in, joining Derek Wilson, Anderson, and Lockett. And now Anderson's going to sit. Jamil Wilson will replace him.
Derek Wilson, 6'1", 215, and he's quick, and he's going to try to keep that body close to Clark and use his strength.
Barlow, a lob way outside to Dunham. Half court set. Fromm, catch and shoot. Three, rimming out. Wilson able to save it for Blue.
Nice set, though, for Fromm from long range.
Vander Blue one-on-one with Barlow. Hard drive. Blue, beautiful delivery. Vander Blue taking it to the hoop.
I think he knows that he can use his size. He's a combination 6'4", but fast as a 6'4 guy, and I think he's thinking that he can use his speed and strength to go over the defender.
Clark off the dribble. He banks it in, Rodney Clark.
Amazing how he gets his shot off when he's really pressured and in trouble. I mean, we saw that game winner that he had. That was like a fall away, but he got it off, right? That's the same type of thing. He just finds a way to get his shot off in traffic.
Double team on Otule, trying to create space. Otule blocked by Fromm.
Yeah, he should have recognized the double team earlier than what he did right there. No place to go.
Butler up by one.
Look at this.
Low one. Clark, a three, falls down. Fromm trying to save it. It's out of bounds.
So here's where Blue takes advantage of the size differential against Barlow. And Fromm from behind can't help out. Blue very good putting the ball on the floor. And there's that little bit of a floater by Clark the other way. Just enough to get himself some separation to put it away.
Devontae Gardner is back in for Marquette. And we'll see Chase DeGaulle for the first time for Butler.
This is a play-by-play guys game here, huh? All the substitutions, the depth. These get used to it, though. They're going to be putting a lot of guys in and keeping legs fresh in this game. I'll just sit back and enjoy.
Yeah, if I'm not paying attention to you, don't be offended. Lockett is fouled on the pass-off. It'll be Marshall picking it up Monday on CBS. TV's best night of comedy is all new, beginning with How I Met Your Mother. Monday at 8, 7 Central, only CBS. Now, Buzz Williams just mixes and matches 18 substitutions here, and we're halfway through the first half.
That's a pretty big number.
Cadogan circling. Blue catching fire. Rims out. And a push. Wilson coming up with a loose ball. Marshall cannot believe it. Foul called on the junior from Davie, Florida.
You know, to my eye, too, Blue really seems comfortable shooting the basketball. I thought that was down. I think he thought it was down. He got a good look. And the most important part about shooting, he's not hesitating at all. When he gets his opportunity, he's going right to his stroke, which usually means you're thinking pretty good about your shot.
Second personal on Marshall, 15 fouls against Butler, also 5 on Marquette. Lob in, intercepted by Smith. Cadogan telegraphed it. Clark whips it ahead. Back in by Smith, they double. Kick out. Stegall catching fire. Cans it, a three.
How about the instincts of Smith, too, in the blocks? I thought he was going to come across the middle of the lane with a little sweeper just then, but instead he swept it across to his teammate to knock it down.
Into the post, Gardner, kick out. Wilson, short on a three. Out of bounds. Vander Blue trying to save it for the Golden Eagles.
Look at this double team. The cross-court pass, nice work there, and you have to be ready as a shooter to let it rip.
That is a play-by-play man. Otule in, and Steve Taylor Jr. in for Marquette. 9-2 run for Butler. So right now, Buzz Williams is looking for the right combination for Marquette.
He's tried a lot of them, by the way.
He has.
just so you're aware of that.
21-17, Bulldogs in front. They can add to it here. Butler is 5 out of 9 from three-point territory.
And the subs still trying to keep fresh legs on Clark. Cadogan has a missed trip.
Roosevelt Jones, a lob. That nearly went in. Hit the front of the rim. That was not a shot attempt. Here's Blue zigzagging through traffic. Bank shot, no, but a foul. The strength of Vander Blue and his ability off the dribble.
Clark went down again right there. Ryan. In traffic with Blue.
He appears to be okay. Helped up off the floor. Rodney Clark had a major scare earlier this season.
Now, and he goes down here, and we're at half court. And you could hear the thud going down.
So Blue at the free throw line, 73%. Let's take you back. This was really a scary moment for Rodney Clark against Dayton in January. The drive to the basket and hit his head on the support. He was taken off on a stretcher and missed 3 games because of the sprained neck.
Yeah, and I was talking to Brad Stevens about this, and Brad said that was one of the most scariest moments he had as a coach, really coaching and in life. You see this kid, and Clark was basically saying the first 5 minutes he had no feeling. They took him off on the stretcher almost at a precautionary standpoint. They had to cut his shirt off, and ironically, Brad Stevens still has that shirt. So that was some shot he took, and thank goodness he's fine, and look at him now. He's going like he's never been hit in his life.
Clark said after 5 minutes, he finally felt some tingling.
Yeah.
Stegall rimming no, and it's rebounded by Otule. Marquette down by two. Wilson feeds it for Blue. The stop and go. Blue can finger roll.
That hesitation will free you up a lot. Oh, we may have a turnover there. Wilson stepping up off the leg of Clark. Clark wasn't ready for a defender to be right on his turnaround hip. But Blue is so good. That hesitation gets people to freeze, and he delivers and brings it to the rack as well as anybody on Marquette's team. And if he's shooting the ball, now watch this quick step in. Little double tip maybe, Clark, leaving it out there.
And that's why Derek Wilson has been in there in the first half. His defensive abilities as an on-the-ball defender. Blue now has 8 points for Marquette. Butler has turned it over four times. And the Golden Eagles can take the lead here. Blue off the drive. Cadogan lines it up. Can't get it to drop from three-point territory. Offensive rebound, Gardner. He traveled.
Yeah, Dunham had the big fella down low with Gardner all over him. Gardner had great position on the offensive glass. Man. No, that's not a dance for Buzz Williams. That's a little, he's saying he got, the big guy got shoved out and rooted out below.
Tied at 21. We come up on 8 minutes to go in this first half. A spot in the Sweet 16 on the line here in Lexington. Jones way outside.
Yeah, he's pretty good going for the basket, so they got to find to get him in the set.
Woods gives it up. Dunham on a pump. The jumper doesn't go, but a foul called. It will be Mayo on the personal. Third round action, the 2013 NCAA Basketball Championship. More March Madness as we continue on CBS. Game summary here at Rupp Arena. Butler and Marquette tied at 21. Butler shooting 5 of 10 from three-point territory. They have turned it over four times here in the first half. Ian Eagle along with Jim Spanarkle and these two teams. And they're going to get to know one another quite well over the next number of years. They're both joining the new look Big
East. Absolutely, they'll get to know one another much better, but kudos to you for picking Clark and Blue to speak about in our open before this game, because they're right on with their 8 points that they're scoring each and leading their teams.
Was that me in the production meeting?
I'm giving you credit for
all
that.
All right, I'm going to take the credit. You don't give it up often. Dunham is off the mark at the free throw line, and Butler with a one-point edge, 16 fouls on each squad. Mayo, younger brother of O.J. Mayo of the Dallas Mavericks. Inside, Wilson had it rejected by Smith. We're down to 7:34 remaining in this first half. Butler leading Marquette by one. They back off Clark. Butler now with five blocks. Dunham gives it up. Clark, he's got a screen set by Woods. Pick and pop. Woods, he'll take the jumper. Wilson with the board for Marquette.
That's that pick and pop that they're going to have to hit, especially if Clark is the trigger man. If they're going to double team him. Yep. Lou loses it up for grabs.
And it's claimed by Jones. Up ahead for Dunham. Nearly lost his footing. Taking it at Mayo. The fend off. The turnaround. Doesn't go. Rebound. Smith got it on his fingertips. But it's Blue the other way for Marquette. Good find. Mayo from the corner. Woods with the board.
Well, you start to break these two teams down pretty quickly, and right off the bat, they've shown us that they're fairly competitively matched. I don't know if there's a real advantage that either of these two teams have right now to be able to take advantage of the other.
Dunham, catch and shoot. Buries it. A three.
I think their advantage, Butler's, may very well be the fact that they go side to side, and they're very good at running Brad Stevens' sets in the half court.
And they are a better shooting team than Marquette. Butler is 6 of 11 from three-point territory, and Buzz Williams is going to make a complete line change. He's got five players at the scorer's table ready to go when we come back from this timeout.
Well, Butler has a little bit of a lead here, and they run their sets very, very well. When you look at Dunham down below, watch where he ends up going over here for the screen. So you have a big exchange out top in front. Smith comes over, sets a staggered screen, moves a touch on it, but that frees up your shooter, Dunham, who has played some of his better games against quality opponents this year.
Jake Thomas in, along with Gardner, Wilson, Taylor, and Lockett.
Butler showing a 2-3 zone right now, too.
Over on TNT, Gonzaga and Wichita State just about set to go. 1 versus 9 in that matchup. Travel called. Devontae Gardner. That is turnover number 5 for Marquette. Watch live games on your computer, iPhone, iPad, and select Android devices with NCAA March Madness Live. Watch now at NCAA.com/March Madness or download the app. Tonight,
we see Butler use both sides of the floor in the last possession on offense. That's exactly what they did at the defensive end there with Woods coming across to help out from the weak side.
There's Smith on the perimeter, defended by Gardner. Clark comes to the ball. Clark the pump. Ooh. And he takes a hit from Wilson, but he is going to the free throw line, and that's 3 free throw attempts for Rodney Clark.
He comes off the screen also, and now watch what he does. He ball fakes. Watch how high the ball comes up over his head, gets the defender to make and commit defensively. And once you're in the air, you want to make sure that you're not diving across into the defender in the air, but getting enough of a piece of him to make sure you get the call. Well done by Clark.
He ended his high school career as the all-time leading scorer in the state of Oklahoma. Attended Arkansas, waited 5 years to get to this point. Playing in the NCAA tournament. Had the transfer year, sat out and watched last year as Butler didn't make the field of 68. And now in his senior season, Clark is a part of it. One of the best deep threats in the country at 41% from three-point territory.
You know what I love about this kid, too?
What's
the ice bath story. After games, he takes ice bath whirlpools. I can't imagine what that feels like, but he says it's the greatest thing for his body in terms of being able to bounce back the next day.
It's cold. I mean, I think you said you couldn't imagine. I believe it's freezing.
It's beyond cold.
28-21, Butler extending the lead with just over 5 minutes to go in this first half. 7-0 run. Clark is the high man with 11. From pick and pop, doesn't take the jumper. Roaming baseline. Jones missed it with the left hand, and the ball came off the rim. Controlled by Taylor for Marquette.
Well, Jones had a better chance to do something stronger with the basketball just then. And he's smacking himself, his hands together. He knows exactly that.
Marquette shooting just 33% from the field.
That's why you're seeing a matchup zone.
Crossover. Cadogan feeds to the corner. Taylor gets rid of it. I should say Thomas gets it back.
Yeah, gotta go by somebody. This is a matchup zone. They keep pointing. There you go. Go by somebody.
Lockett leans in and gets the deuce.
Especially on a matchup. And what that basically means, it has both man-to-man and zone tendencies. When a guy's in your area, you're playing a man-to-man. But that doesn't mean you can't go by him if you do it quick enough also.
28-23. Fromm lines it up. Three ball doesn't go. And rebound secured by Taylor.
Good luck. He's parked.
Altuve unable to finish with the offhand.
I think he could have finished stronger also by turning to the bucket. Make something happen.
Clark. Yes. A three.
Well, Cadogan right in his face also.
Rodney Clark is heating up.
4 for 7. 3 of 6 from 3 for 14. He gets him in a hurry.
Largest lead of the night for Butler. Under 4 minutes to play now in the first half here in Lexington. Cadogan using the Altuve screen. Taylor from the outside, rims out.
And Smith doing his job on the big fella. Altuve not letting him get close to the glass at all.
Here's Clark.
Oh, boy.
Feeling it. Rodney Clark putting up big numbers in the first half.
He's just giving Brad Stevens the stare over there like, I'm feeling it. And Brad Stevens, who doesn't show much emotions, is just looking right through him. But he knows what the storyline is.
16 for Clark. Lockett is fouled by Jones. It's a 12-2 run. Rodney Clark is locked in for Butler.
Yeah.
Marquette trailing Butler by 10 as we bring in the third member of our broadcast team here at Rupp Arena. It's Allie LaForce.
Guys, Butler is one of the few college programs that adopted the Moneyball concept of using statistics and in-depth statistics to make game time decisions. They hired a guy named Drew Cannon, who graduated from Duke with a degree in statistics. What he does is he puts together a massive report for Coach Stevens. Coach Stevens looks it over. They talk for a few minutes, and that's how they decide who's in the starting lineup. And you better believe he played a huge role in Barlow making the start on Thursday and tonight.
Yeah, it's a terrific story. Pete Thamel in Sports Illustrated wrote about it a couple of days ago, and thought the best quote was from Drew's dad, who said that he thought Drew was just going to be living in his basement, but he actually got a job based on the fact that he loved numbers and combined it with his love of sports. And we know where the sport is headed, not just basketball, but sports across the board. The statistical analysis, the deep statistical analysis now that has entered the equation.
Right, and games and practice, the way it leads up to everything, you know, at 3:30 on Thursday afternoon, I hit 6 free throws. I mean, it goes to so deep in terms of the stats, but having 4 children myself, Ian, I can understand his dad's feeling about get out of the basement. Get out.
At the top of the screen, game tracks. You see what's going on right now on TBS. Oregon has got the big lead on St. Louis. Over on TNT, Wichita State and Gonzaga just underway. Arizona has already posted the win over Harvard to advance to the Sweet 16.
Maybe a little more off the bounce in their half-court sets for Marquette.
Jump shot, Wilson. 3 ball doesn't go. Smith corrals the rebound for Butler.
When you're down 8, I think you can get that shot just about any time you want it.
There's Barlow now, half court set. Barlow loses it, and a steal for Vander Blue. Blue fending off. Foul called, and it's Barlow. Coming up, AT&T at the half. We'll get you caught up on all the latest tournament news, highlights, and updates. That's all coming up on AT&T at the half. Barlow may have injured his hand on that defensive play. Second foul called on him. He heads to the Butler bench. Marquette is 9 out of 10 at the free throw line here tonight. Vander Blue shoots it at 73%. Now they are checking out Alex Barlow along the sideline for Butler. Get full coverage of the 2013 Division I Women's Basketball Tournament at NCAA.com/Women's Final Four. Blue is now 6 out of 6 from the line. He's got 10 points to lead the way for Marquette. Butler's got a 6-point lead. Just over 2 minutes to play now in this first half.
And Butler has Clark, who they're looking for.
Blue draws the assignment. Clark gets the roll. Rodney Clark is smoking hot.
And he's got a basket of tricks, doesn't he? He can get the shot off in traffic. Good work there to cut that off by Dunham.
And we will get a tie-up. Possession arrow to Butler. Marquette turns it over. Butler with a chance to bring the lead to double figures.
You know, look at Clark. He's going to come through the middle of the floor. Look at him squeeze through. Then he recognizes from about 13 feet or so that there's nobody coming out to challenge him. A perfect time to throw that little bit of a floater.
Rodney Clark has 18 points since the 17-30 mark. Marquette as a team has 20. Marquette had no turnovers through the first 8 minutes of action. They've turned it over 8 times over the last 10 minutes. And now Butler with an 8-point lead with an opportunity to add to it here.
A little bit of a zone look right now for Marquette.
Smith outside. Out of 1:35 to play, first half in Lexington.
Clark's not going to shoot it out there, but he will take a long-range shot if he comes off the screen against his own.
Clark against Wilson, shot clock down to 10.
Here we go.
Give it up for Jones. Back out. Clark thought about it. They close in on him, so that frees up Jones. He doesn't get the roll. Tapped out by Smith. And now it's Wilson running for Marquette. Rocket drives. Missed it on the inside. Gardner spins. Rejected by Fromm. Knocked out to Mayo. will hit the 1 minute mark of this first half. Butler up by eight.
And Marquette has to finish with a good possession right here.
Wilson goes behind his back. The floater, no. Fromm couldn't grab it. Smith also got his hands on it. Gardner drops it off inside, but he gave it to a smaller guy. Jamil Wilson. And they can't buy one.
What is this?
Mayo, a three, doesn't go. Fromm with the board. And a sequence that Marquette is not going to bottle. Woo. 3 second difference, shot clock to game clock. Butler leading Marquette 35-27. The Golden Eagles have missed on their last seven shots from the field. They're down to 26% shooting.
Yeah, it looks like Brad Stevens calling his set out. He has the confidence with his team right now to be under control.
Seven to shoot. Jones looking for help.
They're in a little trouble now.
And now Stevens will use a timeout. Dunham could not break three on the wing. So Brad Stevens takes the timeout. 6.7 left.
I really should have followed the GPS.
I'll just ask this guy.
Excuse me, sir! Do you know where Christine is?
The Infiniti G Sedan. Because luxury should inspire confidence.
It's not from around here.
No matter what road you take. Right now, you can lease an Infiniti G Sedan for only $299 a month for 24 months. Okay. Infiniti. Inspired performance.
To know the latest news on all your teams with Bleacher Report's TeamStream app. Stay one step ahead. Check out TeamStream on your iPhone, iPad, or Android device tonight. 4 seconds remain on the shot clock. 6.7 on the game clock. Butler with possession, leading 35-27, winding down in this first half.
If you want to get the guards involved, obviously, with the entry pass, as soon as it comes in, right back to a guy who can handle it, you go.
Jones releases off the back of the iron. Rebound, Taylor, and that's how this first half will end. Clark goes 6 of 9 from the field for 18 points. He scores more than half of Butler's points in the first half here at Rupp Arena. Butler in front, 35-27 over Marquette. The winner moves to the Sweet 16 in Washington, D.C. Allie LaFour standing by with Butler coach Brad Stevens.
Coach, Marquette started out shooting the ball really well. Then they started missing. I noticed the switch to the matchup zone. What's working defensively?
Well, one of the things, Marquette does three things outstanding on offense. Get to the foul line, offensive rebound, and shoot two-point field goals. When they made a couple threes early, obviously, you know, that goes against our game plan a little bit. So we've got to make sure that we adjust appropriately but not lose sight of what they do well.
Thanks, Coach. Good luck.
All right, Allie, thanks very much. It is halftime here in Lexington. Butler in front of Marquette, 35-27. We'll send you to AT&T at the half after these messages. You're watching the NCAA Men's Basketball Championship. Getting set for second half action, East Region, 35-27. Butler leading Marquette. Welcome back, everybody, here at Rupp. Ian Eagle along with Jim Spanarkle. Rodney Clark goes for 18. That is more than double Butler's offensive production. Marquette's actually fortunate to be in this game after shooting 26%.
Yeah, and they're not shooting the ball from long range real well. 2 of 7 from the three-point stripe. So Marquette has to make some adjustments, especially against that matchup, to try to get this ball going towards the basket, get some easier buckets, and get their bigs involved.
Let's see how the numbers stack up here. Halftime stats presented by Coke Zero. Butler, 11 of 29. That's 38%. They turned the ball over 5 times in that first half. Allie LaForce moments ago with Buzz Williams of Marquette.
Coach, Rodney Clark got hot for Butler. 18 first half points. How do you contain him?
We got to figure it out. The rest of their team scored 5 baskets and he scored 6. He scored over 50% of their points. You got to limit his touches. Got to play him before the catch. Got to contest every shot, every ball screen he uses. We've got to get the ball out of his hands.
There's one thing you do well, it's play from behind. Good luck in the second half.
We're used to it.
No, Allie and Buzz, he's right. They are used to it. They play a bunch of close games. They're 12-6 this season in games decided by 8 points or fewer. Right now, Marquette is down by 8 as we start the second half here at Rupp Arena. Vander Blue swings it on the outside. Anderson backdoor. Kadugan Anderson, the timing was perfect, almost too perfect that Cadogan wasn't looking up.
Yeah, and here's a team playing from behind, picking up a little bit. And if they had a statistician like Drew Cannon, they would figure out that most of Clark's makes are coming from the right side of the floor.
Smith is fouled inside by Blue.
Well, Clark, when you take a look at him, going to his left, but he loves the right side of the floor. That's where he's had the most success. So I'm thinking that they're going to make some adjustments and try to push him as much as possible to his left. Now, he can shoot it going to his left, but not as successful as a guy who's a right-handed player going to his right.
And the shot chart for Rodney Clark, and the success has been to the right, as you pointed out, Jimmy.
Yep. And you know what? You look at the numbers, and you figure it out and take your chances on pushing them left.
One out of two for Smith. 36-29. Butler, the sixth seed in the East, leading the three seed Marquette.
There you go. Put it on the floor. Make things happen that way.
Kick out. Anderson doesn't take it. Blue cuts the ball. Blocked by Barlow. Marquette able to save. Blue, catch and shoot. Pick it, a three.
Door was open and they really walked through it just then in terms of starting this half. Well, Allie just spoke to Buzz Williams and he said, yeah, we're used to playing from behind. It's what we do. Maybe he's right on the money.
This Butler team 27-8 this season.
And this is a poised Butler team, too, so it'll always be interesting to see how they react.
That push shot. Jones couldn't get it, but the follow goes down as Kyle Marshall was able to hit the offensive boards. 38-32. Lockett swings it. Anderson doesn't take it initially. Kick out. Cadogan lines it up. Short on a three. 50-50 ball goes to Butler. Long range, Rodney Clark! A triple!
Well, that's a delayed break also, running the floor, following up the play. And once again, boy, does he ever let it rip from that right side very successfully.
Just like that, Butler has its largest lead. Lockett got caught on the baseline. Blue, Findoff, over Barlow, and it goes.
And one of the things that Marquette is doing at the defensive end, Ian, is really picking up a little bit more, trying to get more aggressive with the intent at the defensive end. Offensively, we've already seen them, even though Blue shot an outside shot, more of an intention to go towards the basket.
And he's keeping them in it. 15. Rodney Clark is off the mark.
Finds a way to slip through screens, doesn't he?
Cadogan works his way through traffic. Now spread the floor. And Blue is fouled by Barlow. We've got our first Sweet 16 matchup in the 2013 NCAA Basketball Championship. It is Louisville, the number one overall seed in the tournament, and they will match up with Oregon, the 12 seed in the Midwest. That'll be in Indianapolis next week. Barlow called on his third foul. Del Barlow six for Butler. Dunham is in. Just about 3 minutes elapsed in this second half. The back in by Gardner. Repost. Gardner inside. Can't finish it. Lockett busting through for the follow.
Sometimes your best post is your repost. Oh, here's a tough pass.
And a 30-second timeout called by Brad Stevens. The lead is 5 for the Bulldogs.
Well, you get this post-up action, and then you have the follow-up. Marquette is squeezing it towards the middle of the floor.
York run through the 2010 NCAA tournament, but it was a 2008 mission trip to Uganda that was his most memorable moment from college. He was inspired to improve the quality of life for the children he met, and he started the Jukes Foundation for Kids with the primary goal of raising funds to provide financial aid for children in the United States and Uganda. To see the rest of Avery's story and the entire Buick Human Highlight Reel, go to NCAA.com/Buick.
Greg Dummel in New York with a tournament update. Over on TNT in Salt Lake City, the Shockers of Wichita State doing just that to top seed Gonzaga. Jake White for three. Wichita State leads at 29-22. The Shockers 6 of 11 from three. Ian and Jim, back to you.
And Greg, nobody is safe. 2013 NCAA championship. Gonzaga, number one seed. Some people questioned it based on the fact their competition just didn't measure up against the other number one seeds in this tournament. Well, you go out there and prove it.
Now everybody has to prove it, and I kind of agree, but it was hard not to give them a number one seed based on what they had accomplished.
Wow, denied by Lockett, and Marquette almost came away with a loose ball. Nine to shoot. Jones on a kick out for Dunham. Step back over Blue. Doesn't go. Rebounded weak side. Cadogan knocked to the floor, and it's going to work against Marquette. Anderson. Tuesday on CBS, a Navy admiral battles his own son on a powerful new NCIS. Los Angeles, Tuesday, 8 Central. 8 o'clock Eastern, 7 Central, only CBS. Second foul on Anderson. Wilson and Wilson, no relation, will check back in. And Otule will man the middle for Marquette. Second team foul against the Golden Eagles. Early stages of this second half. Jones. Wow, he took a long time, and he gives it away. Vander Blue to the rim. Left hand. Vander Blue. Just tremendous when he shifts gears and switches hands. Going to the basket.
And on that inbounds play, the front line for Marquette sealed the middle of the court perfectly just then, forcing the lob to half court.
Smith lines it up. He cans a triple. 44-38. Blue trying to turn the corner.
Yeah, they're trying to push it a little bit more.
Lockett gets knocked down from behind.
So when you take a look, look at this right in front here. They got the wall, so you can't cut to the basket, and that forces the lob over the top. And Blue's just playing safety right there, and off nice cross, as you just mentioned, quick on the open floor. And then on the other side, Smith is a big guy. Which big guy is going to come out and guard him? Well, nobody's really going to find him quick enough.
Butler is now 9 of 16 from three-point range.
And Marquette's still down 6, Ian, but when you think about it right now, you feel a little bit of a shift and a confidence in a team that, as Buzz Williams said at the half, we're used to playing from behind, and they try to make something happen quickly in the first 5-6 minutes.
Second foul on Jones, and another foul called. It'll be Dunham.
Yeah, I think holding on.
First foul on him, 44-38. Butler.
13 fouls early.
Timeout call. Cadogan couldn't get it in. 16:02 mark, second half. Things tightening up in Lexington.
BlackBerry Z10 with BlackBerry Hub and Flick Typing. Built to keep you moving. See it in action at BlackBerry.com/Z10.
Follow tournament scores, stats, and news live on the CBS Sports app. Get it free by texting SCORE to 42777 or by visiting CBSSports.com/mobile from your phone or tablet. 16:02 mark, second half, they get it in. Cadogan, it goes, and a foul. Cadogan is going to the free throw line. Off the inbounds, Marquette delivers.
That's one of the most difficult ways to enter the basketball, but watch what he does. When he comes around the corner, he's got Smith right with him, 6'11", and he stops on a dime and comes back towards Smith, so he gets Smith going one way. Not the easiest inbounds pass right there either. Well done by Marquette.
Marquette is 11 of 12 from the free throw line. Foul called on Smith, his first. Cadogan shoots it at 72%, and the senior sticks it.
And they continue to stay up, and they're going to try to stick the ball handle at Clark as much as they can. Tire them out just a little bit. You don't want to pull your dribble up, pick your dribble up there.
Gets it ahead. And now Woods will back it out. Defended by Wilson out front. Defense is tightening up. Woods drops it off. Smith, the uncontested lay-in, as Marquette forgot about Smith underneath.
Yeah, I thought Woods was going nowhere in a hurry with three Marquette players within striking distance. You got to give it to your big dad here. Good work.
They go outside in. Gardner will back it out. Blue fires up the three.
Wait a minute.
It goes down for Vander Blue.
Boy, that thing had eyes when it hit the rim, didn't it? Straight up and straight down.
Vander Blue has put up 20 points, and he has cut the Butler lead to two. Clark fires and connects for three.
Blue just shakes his head.
Oh, Butler up by five. Cadogan slips down. Tie up, and a possession arrow goes the other way. Vander Blue dialing it up from long distance.
What's this?
And then Rodney Clark with the answer from downtown. And that number's going to go up. And Allie LaForce has picked up 4,000 new Twitter followers. That's a huge breaking story. Yeah. Yeah, raise the roof, Allie. Absolutely. No? Don't raise the roof? Okay. More Twitter followers, I'm sure, still to come for Allie.
Congratulations, Allie.
Oh, yeah. Butler gets it in off the timeout. Looked like Clark may have injured his right wrist on the previous play before the break in the action. Training staff checked on him, and he's okay. Clark has 24. Blue has 20 to lead Marquette. It's a five-point game with the Bulldogs in front, the number 16. Backdoor. Smith couldn't catch it, and Jamil Wilson comes out of the pack with it.
Good hands by Blue. Pretty good set to start things off with the motion.
Wilson. Off the spin, Wilson got his man in the air, and it's Woods who committed.
Okay, we'll take a look. Here's Clark going after the basketball, and
just out of sorts there, just before he went to the Butler bench.
They're grabbing the chest, grabbing the hand.
Second foul on Woods, 15 foul. It sends Jamil Wilson to the free throw line. He was a big part of that comeback the other day as Marquette came from behind to beat Davidson 59-58. How far will two broke girls go to make their dreams come true? An all-new episode Monday at 9, 8 Central, only CBS. 74% shooter, transfer from Oregon. And the versatility to play that three spot, that four spot, good length at 6'7", 225, and he's got 7 points.
And they keep the pressure on, too, which I think makes sense. They have the depth to do it. They're pushing up. They're just trying to force the action a little bit more, not let Butler get comfortable in their set.
Jones makes his move. He was cut off there. Marquette's defense has definitely amped up in this second half.
With only two team fouls to this point. Butler, on the other hand, has five, so that's an advantage for Marquette.
Smith there sets the screen. The step in. Vander Blue with a steal. And Blue is fouled by Clark.
That's that aggressive approach, starting in the backcourt. Little bounce pass, number one rule, don't bounce past the basketball across that court, especially when you know guys are aggressively coming at you. Now, it's the offensive end of the floor. Butler will have some chances to go backdoor in their sets, but they have to be sharper with their passes in their sets.
Second on Clark, 16 foul. Blue has not missed from the line. He is now 7 of 7, and he's not even touching the rim.
Wow, he's dialed in there, and... Yeah, Clark has his 24 points, and for Buzz Williams, Blue is going to match him pretty soon if this keeps up.
Blue was a major recruit out of Madison, Wisconsin, had an oral commitment to the University of Wisconsin, then changed his mind and ended up with Buzz Williams at Marquette. Knocks down a pair. Marquette has cut the lead to one. Eric Fromm will come back in, and Andrew Smith is going to get a rest.
And I know it was 4 months ago, Ian, but you touched on that Butler Marquette matchup. Blue had 21. Just a reminder that sometimes even 4 months later, matchups still work in your benefit.
It was a 72-71 win for Butler, but a wild ending with Clark hitting a three at the buzzer in Maui.
Clark went for 20 in that game, too.
Leaning in, Jones banks it in. He comes at you from so many different angles.
And so does the shot. That's the important part, to get his shot off. He almost got that shot from his right shoulder.
Entry feed. Gardner coughs it up.
Well, Gardner looked at the official to look for a call. The ball was behind him. He could have snatched it back.
Gonzaga down by 5 at halftime over on TNT against Wichita State. Clark redirects, loses the ball, goes down hard.
Uh-oh, here we go.
Blue gets it ahead. Gardner, the big fella.
Uh-oh, going to the hole. I love it.
He lays it in. Devontae Gardner.
The pass was floated out to him, so he couldn't get a good head of steam up. But the sweet feet took over for him.
51-50, Butler. 7 minutes gone by, second half. And a foul outside as Fromm got knocked down. It'll be Wilson picking it up. That's Derek Wilson, the sophomore.
Watch the height of this pass. He waits for it, and then watch the step. Hey, that's well done right there for a guy his size. 6'8", 290 pounds, soft on his feet, though.
Showing off the agility, going to the hoop, and now Gardner
showing off,
jogging to the Marquette sideline.
And you got to get it in.
And Jones can't. Timeout taken. 13 minutes to play here at Rupp Arena. Winner goes to the Sweet 16.
Flat folding seats plus smart slide entry. The engineering of one detail means you won't always need the other. That's professional grade. Introducing the new GMC Acadia. Now lease the 2013 GMC Acadia SLE for around $299 per month.
Take a look at the Infinity Coaches Spotlight. It's Buzz Williams now in his fifth year as the head man. He's won 20-plus games in each season at Marquette, five straight tournament appearances. He said that he thinks his best talent as a head coach is that he has a pulse for his players. They trust him. They react off of his energy.
Yeah, and let's face it, he's gotten these guys playing, and they're playing much better. They're coming into the season. They were preseason number 7 in the Big East.
They ended up sharing the regular season title with Louisville and Georgetown. Kick out. Fromm lines it up. He buries the three.
Yeah, as mentioned in the first half, he shoots more threes than twos, and they understand that. Great call by Brad Stevens and company to execute.
Wilson against Jones. Wilson coughs it up. Turnover Marquette. 54-50. Butler leads it. Jones handles it out front.
With the pop.
Fromm, ball fake. No call.
No call is right.
And it's saved by Anderson. Blue now with a head of steam. Met by Barlow, who's back in there for Butler. Anderson, the ball fake. Anderson, the flip. Off the iron, it doesn't go. Wilson, able to get his hands on it with Jones. A tie up. Marquette will have the ball.
I think that that's one of the things I, when Anderson's on the floor, Brad Stevens not liking the crawl, but he can shoot that coming through the lane. There's Fromm outside with that look. And let's see if he can, oh yeah, that's definitely a leg trip right there. Inadvertent, accidental, but it's still a trip. And then tie up, good call from the officials there to finish that play off.
Vander Blue, the trigger man.
Oh, it took a long time to get it in, both teams.
Wilson against Dunham. Gardner asking for it. Fromm the help. Drops it inside. And Lockett gets the bucket.
That's a set play for them, too, Ian. And when Gardner gets it, we just talked about him, quote-unquote, showing off with his footwork. How about his passing just then? Little post-up. Nice little spacing on the play.
Marquette shot 34% in the win over Davidson. They've gotten their percentage to 40% now in this second half. We'll get a timeout. Coverage of the NCAA Men's Basketball Championship will continue after this message and a word from your local station. Marquette battling back. Our game summary, 2-point lead for Butler. Marquette shooting 69% in the second half, now 4 of 10 from three-point territory. Welcome back, everybody. Ian Eagle along with Jim Spinarco. Final game here in Lexington. What's changed for Marquette to get back into it?
I think it goes to Buzz Williams' halftime comments to Allie, the fact that we're used to playing from behind. He up-tempoed defensively. Yeah. He picked up full court. I don't think this team gets rattled in the second half, and they play hard, so it's a great combination.
And we'll see how they react now that they've slid back into a 2-3 zone right now, change it up, and that makes a whole lot of sense to have Butler take a look and see how they're going to execute. Now it's back to a man-to-man, it looks like.
Minutes away from the start of Syracuse and Cal over on TBS from San Jose. The scoop goes Roosevelt Jones on a drive to the rim.
And he's not going to shoot the ball from the outside, so why are you going to go out and guard him that closely?
Wilson on a spin, got caught in the air. Now it's Kadugin. Runs it over. Wilson against Fromm. Little bump. Wilson. That's a tough delivery on the interior.
And to continue with the other phase of what they're doing differently, they have really put the ball on the floor and tried to slice their way into the 5 to 7 foot range. There's more of an intent by Marquette, and obviously for a team that struggles from the outside, good adjustment.
Now up to 71% in the second half. Dunham. Three ball doesn't go. Popped up in the air. Lockett trying to save it. Great effort. But he's out of bounds along the baseline.
See, when you have an opportunity to break people down, look at Wilson. He is just very, very good at taking it to the basket. Jones for Butler. And then Wilson down his end using his length and size. So both of those guys really doing exactly what they're supposed to do. And the extra effort. We're going to see a little extra effort coming down the stretch here in this one.
Kadugin and Gardner sit. Otule checks in along with Derek Wilson for Marquette. Jones again having a tough time getting it in. And the denial by Lockett. Moving ahead for Blue. In attack mode, Blue doesn't get the roll. And it's rebounded by the freshman Dunham.
Yeah, he started that leap a little bit too far and then had to kind of cuff it and try to underhand layup. One more step and he could have easily laid that in on the two-on-one break.
Interesting matchup outside. Clark with Wilson. Keep it on the perimeter for Dunham.
Wilson's long out there.
Dunham the drive. The dish inside and a blocking foul called.
Now take a look just a little too soon, and then all of a sudden you have to go up, and it's hard to get that ball to spin back in. It's more of a spin shot. One little extra step, and he lays the ball right in.
Third foul on Derek Wilson.
And Blue with 22, 6 of 10 from the floor, as you mentioned, 8 of 8 from the line. Superb night so far with 10 and change to go.
15 fouls against Marquette. This time Jones elects to throw it to the backcourt 70 feet away.
When in doubt, hoist it three-quarter court.
High screen, Smith. Clark uses it. The pick and pop. Smith will take the three. Way off.
And look at how fast they're getting out of the pack.
Blue tried the blast to the rim, but he was cut off. We've hit the halfway point. Second half in a two-point game. Butler in front. Blue looking for a clear out.
Yeah, they're looking to get to the middle of the floor.
Against Jones. Step back. Blue. Rims out. Rebound. Bodies flying. And last touch by Butler.
It seems like every time there's a whistle, Marquette is substituting.
Celebrate 75 years of March Madness by voting for your all-time players, teams, and moments of the NCAA tournament. Vote now at ncaa.com/March Madness. Winner here will advance to Washington, D.C. to play the winner of the Illinois-Miami game in Austin. That'll be tomorrow night on TNT. Andrew Blue will get it in. Wilson, catch and shoot. Comes off the rim.
And Gardner trying to roll off Smith's back just then to get offensive glass positioning. Smith doing another good job off the glass.
Woods working around the perimeter now for Clark. Tight defense there by Kadugin. Clark had the big first half. He's been fairly quiet in the second half.
Yeah, you got to step off right there in Jones. He's not going to shoot that basketball from out there. So why pressure him so much?
Clark puts it on the floor. Step back. The delivery. Rimming. No. Smith is there. And he gets it to go with the left hand.
Yeah, a little quicker. Smith using his body at the other end of the floor against Gardner and then using his footwork and speed to go around Gardner for the backup.
Buzz Williams calls out a play with his team down by 4. Lockett, the curl. Double comes. Kick out for Blue. Under 9 minutes to play now in Lexington.
Nice matchup against Jones.
And a travel. Vander Blue. Here come the changes for Buzz Williams.
They sure are. Now watch Smith with a little roll of his own. Uses his footwork to get back to the basket to finish it off. Yep, no block out. And if you're not blocked out, Smith very cagey around the offensive glass.
12 turnovers now for Marquette. Butler has 10. Otule is back in along with Anderson and Wilson. Jones handling it with Dunham, Woods, Smith, and Clark, the five on the floor for Butler. Clark makes his move. The runner. And he couldn't come up with a rebound amongst the trees with Anderson and Lockett taking the ball away.
Yeah, some traffic, too, with his shot. He can get it off, but that one's tougher.
Anderson puts it on the deck. Denied! It's the length of Cameron Woods. Coming up Monday on CBS, a jaw-dropping tribute to Bollywood on a new Rules of Engagement. That's Monday, 8:30, 7:30 Central, CBS.
Another whistle, two more substitutions for you, partner.
All right.
57.
Wilson sits along with Lockett, and Cadogan returns along with Jamil Wilson. Wilson, the drive, hangs, deflected up high. Out of bounds. Butler couldn't save it. Buzz Williams was looking for a call underneath the rim.
Yeah. Woods comes in. Watch Dunham, 24, right underneath. He's going to catch one right in the back of the head. See him there holding him, and the ball hits him, too. Everything's going against him. He came out of the pack, rubbing the back of his head, though.
19 blocks for Butler. Marquette maintains possession as we count down to 8 minutes remaining. Second half, Butler 58, Marquette 54. Cadogan. To the rim, Junior Cadogan creating.
Nice high screen. Good call by Buzz Williams. And Cadogan reading that screen perfectly. Allows them to pick up full court again. They're not looking for a turnover here, but what they are looking for is just to force the action. Pick up Butler's pace a little bit.
The Butler lead is two. Jones out front.
He'll obviously take the turnover if it comes, but not the intent.
Dunham looking to feed the post. Smith couldn't break it free. Dunham loses the ball. Swept out of there by Otule. And a break opportunity. Lays it in. Great feed. Up the floor. And Vander Blue has tied this game at 58.
We've seen some beautiful passing in the tournament so far, Ian, but I'm going to put that one right in the top five. That was threaded perfectly.
Jones trying to use the screen, set by Woods. Another steal. Blue strikes in for the two-handed flush. Marquette's got its first lead since 17-16. And the Golden Eagles are soaring at Ruff. Timeout.
At his current pace, Bob will retire when he's 153, which would be fine if Bob were a vampire. But he's not. He's an architect with two kids and a mortgage. Luckily, he found someone who gave him a fresh perspective on his portfolio. And with some planning and effort, hopefully Bob can retire at a more appropriate age. It's not rocket science, it's just common sense. From TD Ameritrade.
Marquette has put together about 13 minutes of solid defensive effort. They are closing, they are squeezing, they're helping one another out, and it's turning into transition buckets for them, getting down the floor in a hurry. And Blue really doing his job, stepping into the passing lane, pushing the action. Butler's a team that doesn't really get rattled too much because they are just like their coach, Brad Stevens. So he has a great calming effect on this team in terms of getting them back on page. And what he does a lot in his timeouts, he'll bring his team over. He'll explain to them that you did something wrong. He'll tell you how to correct what you've done wrong. And then he gets you back on the floor and says, now go play and worry about the next play.
Well, right now, a stoppage here with Mike Stewart dealing with some business at the scorer's table. Keep this in mind. Butler has one timeout remaining at the 7:05 mark of this second half. Buzz Williams is trying to make his case. I think the substitutions were the question. As we know, Buzz Williams will just make changes in waves.
And the official, it's not so much that he has to be there in time, but he has to be, the official has to recognize it, and also before he hands the ball over.
He's got to check in.
Yeah, well, but there's been so many of them. You don't know who's coming and going in this game for Marquette.
Vander Blue gets a breather. He's got 26 points to lead all scorers.
Great evening to this point.
60-58. Marquette in front. Slapped out of bounds. Unfortunate because Clark fell down on the play. 6:51 left at Rupp Arena. Marquette up by two. Tonight on CBS, a former NFL player and his girlfriend convicted of murdering a millionaire. Why did he ask 48 hours to come see him in prison? He says he's ready to reveal who really did it. 48 hours, that's tonight, only CBS. 60-58, Marquette leading Butler. 66 substitutions for Buzz Williams, who just towled off at the end of that timeout.
Has to be nearing a record in the NCAA, don't you think?
I have no idea.
Somebody's keeping count.
You should research that here in the second half. Marshall on a spin. It's an air ball. Cadogan handling it. The senior point guard for Marquette. Now it's Lockett.
Whoop,
Wilson. He traveled. Didn't put it on the floor when he took that big first step.
I think there's such a sense of urgency for Marquette, and not in a bad way, but to make sure they're getting things going towards the basket for Buzz Williams, is that he just didn't put the ball down then.
Sweet 16 each of the last 2 years for the Golden Eagles. Butler didn't make the tournament last year after back-to-back appearances in the NBA championship game. Did I say NBA?
He did.
Wow. They really played well.
Great look over the top to Smith.
Andrew Smith with the finish.
Bring on the heat.
Did they lose to Miami 2 years ago? I'm trying to retrace my steps. Tied at 60. Locked it out front on a dump down for Otule. And a foul called from behind.
Yeah, Butler comes back. They need one over the top. They get it. Oh, that is just a perfect, perfect read. Did you see the big fella? Otule couldn't get it. You know, he was like almost stuck in deep snow just then. He saw the ball coming, couldn't react quick enough to it.
Second foul on Smith. 17 fouls against Butler.
Here's the difference, too. Ian Gardner is 84%. The other half of the big centers, Otule at...
Inverted, 48%.
Yep, thank you. Didn't want to say it while he was shooting.
And now Marquette is 16 of 18 from the free throw line. We are tied at 60 with 5:40 to go. Second half.
This is similar to the Maui game, isn't it? When they played one another, yep. Just down to the wire.
Jones gives it up. Marshall, kick out. Stegall couldn't get a clean look.
They are recognizing the shooters and backing off, like right here, without the shooter.
Clark using the screen. There's the roll. And the slam! It's Marshall on a rack attack.
What a delayed cut and a beautiful delivery after Clark had somebody close on him. Wilson with the big.
Butler up by two, and Marshall is called for the foul against Lockett.
A terrific read by Clark. Watch this. He gets by. He thinks he has a shot. Tall guy closes, and so does Marshall. Beautiful dunk.
That's number three on Marshall. Lockett will head to the free throw line. 18 fouls now against Butler. Otule sits. Gardner replaces him for Marquette.
Lockett okay at the line. Also 2-for-2 tonight. 74% free throw shooter.
He's played well. 11 points, 6 rebounds. He drains the first.
Yeah, he's got a real good stroke at the free throw line.
Transfer from Arizona State. Transferred after wrapping up his undergraduate degree in 3 years and got the waiver to come to Marquette. His mom, Judy, has been battling cancer, and she was in attendance here the other night. I'm sure she's here tonight as well.
And doing much better also is the report on her, so that's great news.
Locked up at 62 apiece, under 5 minutes to play here in Lexington.
Marquette 18 for 20 from the free throw line. That's been the difference.
There's Clark on a crossover. Smith sets the screen.
Yep, big help again by Gardner. They got Smith, though. Oh, too high.
Jones had the right idea, and it glances off of Smith out of bounds.
The reason why that ball went high is that he did not recognize him quick enough. He was wide open for a beat of about 2 seconds, and then the last part of it, he sees him, and then he hurries his pass.
Each team has turned it over 13 times, but 8 for Butler in this half. And Marquette has taken advantage of the turnovers. They've turned those mistakes into points. Lock it out front. Blue is back in. Blue strokes it for two. Doesn't go. Rebounded. Clark has got it. Took another shot. And Winston Payne after the rebound.
And they're going to start setting the high. Yep, here comes the high screen.
Smith sets it. Clark fires. It's offline. Too short. Out of bounds. DeGaulle could not control it cleanly.
You notice going to his left, Clark just then also was drifting a bit. Well, that was a clean one and just lost it. He had his hands on it. That could have been a second possession. It's this guy never gets rattled, does he, Brad Stevens?
Same demeanor. He said that he modeled himself after former Indianapolis Colts head coach Tony Dungy. Cadogan, it's good, and a foul. Junior Cadogan with a chance for three.
The higher percentage shot is obviously going to the basket. What Marquette has done very well in this second half is turned this into a paint game, so to speak, if you will. Everything is focusing on the paint first, the post, the drive, and then if they have to kick it out, so be it for an open shot. Great job there, though, by Cadogan to use his strength and size and quickness. Now, Blue has been carrying them from a scoring standpoint, but don't forget about Cadogan. He's one of the leaders on this team and will take a tough shot. He doesn't like the long-range one, but he does love the 15-footer and in type of pull-up jumper, too.
Third foul on Smith. 19 fouls against Butler. Cadogan has scored all nine of his points in the second half. 64-62 Marquette. Smith.
Watch for a backdoor cut.
Clark, the floater. In and out. Gardner slaps it outside, and it's tracked down by Dunham of Butler.
Yeah, that's not a bad tip out, though, because he gets it away from the offensive rebounder.
Clark on a bounce. Jones. It goes! And it's going to be waved off.
Oh,
did Smith touch that ball is the question. The officials will come together. If he touched it, the basket won't count. If he didn't, it's continuation.
Well, let's take a look. He shoots this one off the dribble. This is how he shoots his shot, so it's not surprising for the shot. Let me see here. Oh, he may have touched the bottom of the ball on that.
It looked like he touched the bottom of the rim,
too.
Brad Stevens asking the officials.
What a great shot.
It should count for Butler. It doesn't.
Well, take a look at the arrow, right? We're going to take a look at this shot and whether or not he hits the basketball or not. He doesn't get the basketball, but by rule, if the ball is sitting over the cylinder and he hits the rim, then they're going to call this offensive interference. You see, he's on the rim and pulls it a little bit even. So the officials working that out. I love this reaction. You can't get any better. And unfortunately, it's going to go against Butler. But they get to the line. So once again, shot. It was in the act of shooting. He goes to the line for his two, but the basket waved off.
And the reality is that Smith touching the rim probably did not affect the ball whatsoever.
Agreed.
But by rule, you do affect potentially the ball rolling around or giving it an extra little push.
Exactly. And you can't make, to your point, you can't anticipate or call out or predict, so you go with it.
One out of two for Jones at the line. Butler cuts the Marquette lead to one. We're down to 3:24 to play in the second half. This has been a battle.
This is what the tournament is all about right here.
Blue gets bumped outside. Great luck. Finds the open man. Gardner off the hesitation. And the foul will be called on Lockett off the rebound action as Smith took a hard fall. Right now he is leaning on the official's leg.
This will be team foul number seven also. Now Gardner had one very close. Wow, that's a pretty good hit. Lockett with the foul there in the follow-up.
And he ends up on the right leg of Lamont Simpson, who didn't move, allowed Smith to gather himself for a few seconds. Third foul on Lockett, 17th foul, so Smith is at the free throw line for 1-1.
72% shooter, who's 2-for-4.
We are tied at 64. 12 points for the senior Andrew Smith. His scoring has increased every season at Butler, averaging 11 points per game. Butler in front by one, just over 3 minutes to play.
a game of possessions that we talked about right from the beginning of this game, Ian. It's going to come down. Every possession right now is so important.
Wilson makes his move. Wilson. Oh, tough shot. Jamil Wilson able to will that one through for Marquette.
This is too much.
He's in double figures with 11, 66-65, Golden Eagle.
Buzz Williams is laughing over on the sideline the way that ball hung on the rim.
There's Jones. Handoff for Barlow. Clark trying to get to the ball. Instead, they go to the other side and Jones. Barlow, the pump. 12 to shoot. Butler down by one. Barlow, the drive and dish. Jumper for Woods. He cans it.
Great decision by Barlow just then. I had two facets to his move. Number one, he didn't shoot the ball from long range where he's only a 23% shooter, but he brings it to the middle for a setup play.
Blue, the bank shot doesn't go, and it's going the other way. Offensive foul on Vander Blue.
Clark has been quiet. Buzz Williams watching the play in disagreement, but watch for Clark stepping over. Right there, he strides, he gets his feet squared to the shooter.
Second foul on Blue.
Yeah, that's one of those, that's another tough call in my estimation, because I'm not so sure Blue really banged into him, but Clark established.
67-66 Butler. We are under 2 minutes to play now in Lexington. The winner goes to Washington, D.C. in the Sweet 16.
Not going to be in a hurry here, but they're down to 15-ish right now, so they have to make a good set. Right now, this next pass and play has to get something going for them.
Clark one-on-one against Wilson. 10 to shoot. Jones the lob. Smith the catch. Two defenders. He's fouled from behind. He was able to get Devontae Gardner to lean, and Smith established tremendous position after the looping feed.
Well, you take a drive here. And look at this shot right here. Look how long this sits. Where is it going? It's going towards the basket, and it drops. And here's that drop pass. Nice little soft six-footer from the baseline.
Second foul on Gardner. Smith has 13 points, 8 rebounds, 2 blocks. Hits the first free throw. The lead is 2. Derek Wilson will sit, replaced by Junior Cadogan.
And against Bucknell, remember, too, that he shot the basketball well. 7 of 8 from the line. So Smith comfortable in big-time spots for this team.
Butler was 25 of 28 from the free throw line in that victory over Bucknell. 69-66, Butler with the lead. 1:25 to play. Cadogan, kick out. Blue fires for the tie. Bucket, a three. Vander Blue, we are knotted at 69 apiece with a minute 15 to play.
Remember against Davidson, they came alive shooting the basketball down the stretch. We've got a carbon copy of these two playing it out here with just a touch over a minute to go.
29 for Vander Blue. Smith gives it up. Now it's Jones, 14 to shoot.
Not going to shoot it from the outside. Good slip to the lane.
Wilson, kick out Barlow. He can't hit the three. A foul, and it's going the other way. Over the back, Cameron Woods. That is 10 team fouls against Butler. Free throws coming up for Marquette.
What a drive. You get the defender to kick in. It's too late for the reaction. Blue has just been absolutely spectacular with 29. Tough call goes against Woods and Butler.
47.7 remaining. Second half. Marquette and Butler tied at 69. Two free throws for Jamil Wilson. 11 points, 5 rebounds. He is 2 of 2 from the free throw line. A chance to put Marquette in front.
Keep in mind, Butler does have one timeout left. Look at the poise, though, with Brad Stevens, right? He's not going to show that you're rattled.
Marquette leads by one. Second free throw for Wilson. Knocks down a pair. 71-69. Golden Eagles lead it.
It's been effective for them the entire second half, so why not keep the pressure on? Now you're going to see the poise of Butler right now. If they can pull this down, get it across, and let's see if they use both sides of the floor.
12-second difference, shot clock to game clock. Winding down here with Marquette in front by two.
Months of preparation and running your sets.
Smith trying to force a pass inside, and it's taken away by Marquette.
They're wasting time. They have to get up. And
why didn't they foul?
They got a foul. It's
they
the wrong
do now.
Guy. It was 84%.
Devontae Gardner will go to the free throw line. Blue was in the backcourt. They could have got him at 73%. Wilson was available, a 74% shooter.
Yeah, so right now, you can count the seconds off. I'm going to guess there were about 10 seconds that they had, approximately. They could have fouled earlier.
Marquette with an opportunity to make this a two-possession game with Devontae Gardner, the junior from Suffolk, Virginia, at the free throw line. 84% this season. Connects. 72-69 Marquette.
He makes this shot, Iron. Whether he makes it or not, you're down three or four with 22.9 seconds left. I think you can come down if you're Butler and go right to the basket with it. Think two first. If you got to kick it out, look. But you have to really stretch the clock right now. The best way to do that is to try to take it down the floor in a hurry.
Second attempt, Gardner, it rims out. It's a three-point game.
Depending on how much time is off this clock when they get it, will dictate whether they're going three or two.
And that's going to send Jones to the free throw line. Third round continues tomorrow, noon Eastern, CBS, Iowa State, Ohio State, 6:10, Minnesota and Florida, also Florida Gulf Coast in action as well. Eight games across CBS, TNT, TBS, and True TV over 12 hours.
And interesting enough, that foul just then puts a 55% free throw shooter to the line in Jones.
Sophomore from O'Fallon, Illinois, with his team down by three, 14.7 remaining on the clock.
And he has an odd shot. The interesting part in watching him in practice, he's got an odd shot for a jump shot, but when he gets to the line, the rotation on his shot at the free throw line is probably as good as you're ever going to see. And that doesn't necessarily mean the ball's going in either.
This extended wait is because Jones went down, and that area now is very sticky.
Yeah, and if you're that young fellow there with the mop, you want to take your time here on national TV.
Just the fact that it may ice Roosevelt Jones,
right.
That's not your concern. After all the games are over, catch all the highlights and analysis on Inside March Madness, presented by Buick, only on TBS.
And we've seen this here with our games, situations like this. And what it may very well do, it just saved Brad Stevens a timeout because he just pulled his troops together to kind of say, okay, miss or make, here's what we have to do. Think it through, and Jones goes to the line, as I mentioned, at 55%.
Two free throws. Jones hits the first.
And he hits the front rim, Ian, but to my point about backspin on the basketball, it took it right over the front rim for him. Just an amazing amount of backspin he puts on the ball, which helps free throw shooters when they get it over the front rim.
Second one to cut it to one. 14.7 on the clock. It's short. Rebound. Front floor. Knocked out of bounds. Last touched by Marquette. Butler's going to have it with 13 seconds to play. And it was Gardner who could not squeeze it for the Golden Eagles.
Yeah, Brad Stevens is so intent on being able to coach from the sidelines. He has one timeout left. If he has trouble, he'll call it.
Jones.
Oh, boy.
Gets it in long for Smith. We are down to 10 seconds left. Butler down by two. Clark for the lead. Air ball. And it's out of bounds with 5.5. Rodney Clark from long range. And again on the left side, missing the rim.
And going to the right is how he won that game in Maui against his team. Going to the left, not as effective. You're down two, 5.5 seconds left. You go for a one-second steal right here, and then you foul who's ever around you. You don't do it by selection. You foul whoever catches it.
Blue gets it in.
Oh, boy.
Gardner ahead, and they got the foul. Gardner said, I didn't want the foul. He had an open man down the floor.
He doesn't get to choose that, though.
Let's see. Did he get... Oh, that's a close call, isn't it?
Boy, he got rid of that ball. If there's no call there, this game is over.
Yeah, exactly.
Instead, Butler has a slight opening right now with Devontae Gardner at the free throw line. 4.7 on the clock. He is 4 of 6 from the line tonight. First one is good. 73-70.
What great hands. Smooth shot at the line.
Smith will check back in for Butler.
If you're Marquette and Brad Stevens bypasses his timeout, you just have to stay away. Now, if he misses this shot, then you have a real interesting call on Marquette's part as to whether they're going to foul or not. And depending on where the ball gets to and how much time is left, you may very well want to do that.
Gardner sticks the free throw. It's a 4-point lead for Marquette.
See, if you're Marquette now, what you want to do is you want to force and let the ball come towards the inbounds passer with Butler. Let them catch it there. But this is going over the top, baseball style.
Emerson Campen gets it in, and it's Smith. It's going to count. Goaltending. Campen has not played yet in the NCAA tournament, but he's the best inbounder on the Butler roster, and he got the ball down the floor to Smith for the bucket. 3.2 remaining.
Same exercise right here for Butler. Whoever catches it, foul him immediately. You don't really even have time, unless there's a fumbled catch, just foul whoever catches it.
Blue will toss it in. He lobs it.
Let's
out of bounds. Too far for Wilson. And with 2.4 left, Butler is going to get it back.
I think they're going to get it right on the sideline. Because to my eye, let's see if this is a deflection. And I believe it is. That ball is going to go right to the sideline.
Think back 2 days ago when Marquette was on the other end of a ball out of bounds on the sideline, and Marquette benefited from it after Davidson turned it over with a chance to ice the game. These two teams played early in the season, in November, in Maui. Rodney Clark, a wild desperation three to win it at the buzzer for Butler over Marquette, 72-71. The score here, Marquette 74, Butler 72 with 2.4 left.
First thing that goes through my mind right now is that you think Marquette knows that Clark beat them 4 months ago, and the answer to that is definitely yes. So now you have two options in my mind. You can take Clark and run him. Okay, we're just going to look at this call to see what the timing on it.
Officials looking exactly when it went out of bounds.
They'll figure that out at about 2-8-ish or give or take a little bit. But don't be surprised to see Clark as a decoy here, Ian. Have him run as hard as he can off a couple of screens and then have them try to go over the top for a lay-in lob on this play right now.
They put 2.9 on the clock for Butler to work with.
And one of the things Butler does so very, very well is they have a lot of motion. They set a lot of good screens. And they come out of the pack right now. They're not excited. Buzz Williams talking his guys through this to make it straight up.
No timeouts remaining. Butler had 2 magical March runs in 2010 and 2011.
Nice move putting Gardner up on the ball. That's going to make it more difficult for the lob pass or an inbounds pass.
74-72, Marquette in front. Jones looking to get it in. A lot of movement. Fires to Smith. Smith tries to get a shot off. It's over. Marquette holds on. The Golden Eagles are gone to the Sweet 16 for the third straight year. And it took a defensive stand to do it for Buzz Williams and company. Marquette gets the win over Butler. 74-72. Andrew Smith could not get a clean shot off at the buzzer.
Well, Buzz Williams' team was down 8 points at the half, and they made some adjustments, and the two adjustments have paid off. The ability to go full court, up-tempo the defense, which I thought was terrific, and also they decided we're bringing this ball on the offensive end of the floor into the paint, and we're going to take it at you until you force us to the outside.
These two teams are going to see a lot of one another coming up in the new Big East. But this night belongs to Marquette.
Yeah, did you notice Smith's left ankle just then buckled for him? Watch as he catches it. Watch the footwork more than anything. The shot doesn't get off, right? It's not going to matter. But watch right there. You see how his footwork gets tangled up? He gets no lift at all. And it's really not a shot at that point. It's kind of a throw up at the basket, which he had to do. And he recognized that he didn't have much of a shot to get off.
A flail at the buzzer. Yep. Jamil Wilson closed in on Smith defensively, and that's how it ends. Nearly a fantastic finish in Lexington. What a game between Marquette and Butler.
That was a fabulous, fabulous basketball game.
Marquette advances to Washington, D.C., going to the Sweet 16 for the third consecutive year. The number three seed, you can put them in D.C. They'll take on Illinois and Miami tomorrow night on TNT. 48 Hours Mystery is coming up here on CBS. Tune into TNT and TBS now for live third-round games. For Jim Spinarco, Allie LaForce, the rest of our crew, I'm Ian Eagle. So long from Lexington, where Marquette gets the win. Dramatic ending here at Rupp. We'll send it to our studio after this.